Good morning.
Good morning.
Those who throw cold water on expository preaching, well, they typically point out the challenges that are supposedly imposed on preachers and hearers alike. In their view, those challenges are fatal. There are those who, for instance, say that book by book, verse by verse exposition forces preachers and the people with them into highly controversial and difficult passages. At the other end of the spectrum, it also forces them, they say, into what they consider trivial passages. Well, we've already seen in 2 years almost in Jude, in 1 Peter, in 2 Peter, and now Philippians, and those of you who were with Paranaque before for almost 3 years in Matthew, that those challenges are really not valid. We've worked our way successfully through some of the supposedly impossibly difficult and controversial passages. For example, Jesus preaching to the dead in 1 Peter chapter 4. Reviling angelic majesties in Jude 8 in 2 Peter in chapter 2. And the consistent tension in the sovereignty of God, man's responsibility in 2 Peter. And just recently, if you remember, even in Philippians chapter 2. Now, over that same period, we haven't encountered any of the so-called trivial passages they refer to. The Apostle Paul, at some time, gets into personal greetings toward the end of the epistles, his epistles, as he does that in Colossians chapter 4, in 2 Timothy chapter 4, in Philemon. But because we haven't done Paul until Philippians, we haven't seen those yet. But if anything, those are the sections, the ones in the Pauline epistles, that would probably be closest to what they mean by trivial passages. All of that until I found out that I was preaching on Epaphroditus today. Quickly reading through that passage, Philippians chapter 2, 25 to 30, my first thought was, okay, looks like we're getting into one of those now. Well, let's all stand and let's read the passage together so you get a sense of that. We're in Philippians chapter 2. 25 to 27, let's read this together so we honor the word of God. Verse 25, but I thought it necessary to send to you Epaphroditus, my brother and fellow worker, fellow soldier, who is also your messenger and minister to my need, because he was longing for you all, was distressed because you had heard that he was sick. For indeed, he was sick to the point of death. But God had mercy on him, and not only on him, but also on me, so that I would not have sorrow upon sorrow. Therefore, I have sent him all the more eagerly, so that you may see him again, and you may rejoice, and I may be less concerned about you. Receive him then in the Lord with all joy. Hold men like him in high regard, because he came close to death for the work of Christ, risking his life to complete what was deficient in your service to me. Let's pray. Our Father, we know that there are no such things as trivial words in your word. There may be words that we do not completely understand or appreciate, words that we may not know exactly how to apply or even to connect to ourselves. But Lord, we trust that your words are divinely inspired, and that you and your Spirit work with us as we go through these passages. Would you do that today? Would you help us through this passage and make sure we understand it as we should? In Christ's name we pray. Amen. Thank you. You may be seated. You will notice from a quick first reading, number one, there are no revelations about God that immediately grabs your attention. No immediately evident theological tracts that reveal some exciting or headline-grabbing truth about God in this passage. You will also notice that there are no soteriological tracks there either, no threads that enlighten us, lead us to how we might be more effective as evangelists, as apologists. And thirdly, I did notice this, that the Apostle Paul usually drops his trivial, quote-unquote, trivial greetings and exhortations toward the end of his letters. But curiously, his words on Epaphroditus are right in the middle of Philippians, not at the end, you will notice. Well, I thought that was most hopeful. Obviously, these words are meant to be far more than Paul's other closing greetings and exhortations. And like I customarily do, I read through our passage every day again and again. I also read through the sections before it, sections after, and I did that again and again until I began to live in the passage. Amazing how passages spring to life after several days of doing that. And happily, this one too didn't disappoint. I've always said it is criminal to bore people with the scriptures, so I was quite wary that I would one day preach a trivial passage. And I have to say, it was quite a challenge to get going, because there really didn't seem all that much to dig into this passage. But it didn't really take long before I was thoroughly caught up in the text. That happened when I discovered that I couldn't have been more wrong. I discovered that this was anything but a trivial passage. I soon discovered how Philippians chapter 2, 25 through 30 leads us to some really important nuggets of truth and applications about ourselves that we all so badly need. Looking at the passage broadly, there is one thing that very clearly stands out, that Paul had chosen to put these two commendations side by side. The commendation of Timothy in Philippians chapter 2, 19 to 23, which Dr. Rico took us through last week, and this one of Epaphroditus in this passage in Philippians 2, 25 through 30. Now, that was most remarkable because of how different those two people are. Epaphroditus from Timothy, one from the other. You see, unlike Timothy, Epaphroditus is not a very prominent person in the New Testament. And while Epaphroditus was well known to the Philippians, he is certainly not well known to any of us. That's because his name only appears twice in the New Testament. Both of those times are in Philippians, here in our passage today, and in chapter 4, verse 18. Timothy, on the other hand, is very clearly quite the celebrity. He's named again and again and again, 24 times, in fact, in the New Testament. What struck me as most curious was this, that all of that notwithstanding, Paul gives Epaphroditus obvious, even surprising prominence in our text. Paul actually devotes more words to Epaphroditus than he does to commend Timothy. Looking closely, take careful note of how Paul describes Epaphroditus. Verse 25, I thought it necessary to send to you Epaphroditus, my brother, my fellow worker, fellow soldier, who is also your messenger and minister to my need. Firstly, he describes Epaphroditus using three obviously endearing titles. My brother, my fellow worker, fellow soldier. Among other things, by prefacing all of those three with the possessive pronoun, my, Paul is very clearly expressing a deep and authentic loving relationship with Epaphroditus. The Apostle Paul was one of the most respected and loved leaders in the early church, and it mustn't escape our notice that this great man has chosen to call an ordinary and virtually unknown believer all of that. He calls him not only his brother, he calls him his fellow worker, his fellow soldier in the service of the Lord Jesus Christ. Secondly, Paul describes Epaphroditus as your messenger and your minister to my need. You see, the word messenger, apostolos, is the in the original language, is very often rendered apostle in the New Testament. Now, it's quite obvious that Epaphroditus was not an apostle, not in the same sense that Paul was. But again, I want you to take note that Paul has deliberately chosen the most dignified and honorable term he could think of to describe Epaphroditus. Now, the same thing can be said for your minister, Laetorgos, in the original language. Laetorgos has a broad range of meanings and applications. It was used in the ancient Greek of a public official who was so passionately dedicated to his duties that he discharged them at his own expense. The word is also often used to describe a service of such special importance, and the responsible Laetorgos, thereby highly respected and honored. Paul refers to human rulers in general as servants. That means Laetorgoi of God in Romans chapter 13, verse 6, who are to be respected and obeyed in that passage, it says. See, from the foregoing, it's very clear that Paul speaks of Epaphroditus in the highest of terms. Highest of terms. Now, what had Epaphroditus done to deserve all of that? That's the thing, isn't it? It's what we all need to see into this morning. It's a crucial point that many people miss when they read through all of this. And to appreciate all of that, we need to firstly see just how different Timothy was from Epaphroditus. Timothy and Epaphroditus' work, well, they were very, very different one from the other. Timothy, as Dr. Rico took us through last week, was a protege of Paul. He ministered in Paul's behalf and very often in his place. And like Timothy, like Paul, Timothy taught and preached God's word. He was very often, he was sent often as Paul's troubleshooter. You can clearly see that in 1 Timothy chapter 1, in 1 Timothy chapter 4. But Epaphroditus was never into anything even remotely close to that. Epaphroditus' initial assignment was very simply to bring the Philippian church's gift, financial gift, to Paul, and that's in Philippians chapter 4, verse 18. The task did not require a teacher or a preacher. What it did require was a man of character. One who would see to it that the funds reached Paul intact. Now, Epaphroditus was himself another gift from the Philippians to Paul. Aside from bringing money, the Philippian church also had Epaphroditus to minister to Paul's personal and ministry needs. But get this, nowhere are we told that Paul sent him out to teach and preach. Nowhere. And when Paul sent him back to Philippi, it wasn't to teach and preach in Philippi. He was sent back home to comfort his heart and to comfort the hearts of those in Philippi who loved him. We just read that, Philippians chapter 2, verse 28. So it's quite a difference between the work of Timothy and Epaphroditus. Timothy, he ministered for Paul by going to places that Paul was unable to go to. By his preaching and his teaching, Timothy extended, some might even say multiplied, the ministry of the apostle, and thus the work of the gospel. Epaphroditus, on the other hand, ministered to Paul personally. He probably ran errands for the apostle, doing things for him that Paul couldn't do because of his incarceration in Rome. Epaphroditus facilitated the ministry of Paul. While Timothy served as Paul's mouth, Epaphroditus served as Paul's hands and feet. That's what he did. Now, I want you to notice that despite those differences, Paul flatly refuses to differentiate Epaphroditus' work and ministry from that of Timothy. And in fact, even from his own ministry. Philippians chapter 2, verse 25 says, I thought it necessary to send to you Epaphroditus, my brother, fellow worker and fellow soldier. Notice how Paul communicates that determination very clearly. He says Epaphroditus was his fellow worker. He's emphasizing their common spiritual work in addition to their common spiritual life as brothers. Synergos, fellow worker, is a distinctly Pauline term. Of the 13 times that it is used in the New Testament, all but one are by Paul. In every instance, it carries the meaning, the idea of an affectionate partnership, not merely an impersonal, an official relationship. And you'll find that all in Romans chapter 16, Colossians chapter 4, and 1 Thessalonians chapter 3. He says, Epaphroditus was a fellow soldier. He's calling to mind their joint struggle against common spiritual enemies. Clearly, very clearly, the Apostle Paul looked at Epaphroditus not as a subordinate, but as a spiritual warrior he worked with side by side in the service of the Lord Jesus Christ. The terms that Paul uses says it all. They convey his very high regard for the man and for his ministry. He speaks of Epaphroditus as his equal, as his colleague, definitely not just his servant or subordinate. There are times when Paul finds it necessary to assert his calling and his authority as an apostle, but that wasn't necessary with the Philippians. And instead here, Paul feels free to open his heart and to speak of Epaphroditus with obvious and great affection. He refers to Epaphroditus and himself as brothers, both working in the cause of the gospel, fighting side by side for the faith against all opposition. The Apostle Paul knew exactly what he was doing. He knew that those back home in Philippi had received words of Epaphroditus' illness, but evidently not the complete story of his recovery. He knew Epaphroditus was distressed. Distressed not because he had been sick and almost died. No, he was distressed because folks at home might be worried sick, assuming the worst. He was distressed because they were unnecessarily worried. Verse 26. The text implies Epaphroditus was determined to remain at Paul's side, ministering to him in every way, any way that he could. Did you catch that? He had been seriously ill. He had almost died from it, but through it all, he wouldn't abandon his post. Philippians chapter 2, 26 to 28 says he was longing for you all and was distressed because you had heard that he was sick. Indeed, he was sick to the point of death, it says. Therefore, I have sent him all the more eagerly so that you might see him again and you may rejoice. Note carefully that it was Paul's move to send Epaphroditus back home. You know, Epaphroditus' homecoming would end his distress, as well as the distress of those in Philippi. And it would also end Paul's distress as well, we're told in verse 27. It must have been terribly inconvenient. Must have been very difficult for Paul to send his dear brother, fellow worker, fellow soldier back home. But he does. And having decided that, Paul commands the Philippians to welcome the man as a true hero of the faith. Verse 29. In your life, have you ever seen anything like this? How many men in Paul's position do you know who would go this way? Someone who'd go so far to commend someone like Epaphroditus. Someone so low in the totem pole, serving almost like a personal alalay. Or maybe the more appropriate word is achoy. You know, I don't know about you, but I haven't met many people who are like that. I've known some so petty who'd find it next to impossible to embrace and treasure those they work with who are like Epaphroditus. Some would probably write this way: Paul, esteemed apostle, handpicked by God, to all of those under my charge in Philippi. As you know, mission work is very demanding, and only the strong of heart can endure conditions such as I am presently experiencing. Unfortunately, Epaphroditus is not a strong man physically. His trip to Rome was too much for him, and he almost succumbed to his illness. Fortunately, I was able to nurse him back to good health. Epaphroditus is not so strong in spirit. He simply could not hold up against the stress of the situation. He became so homesick, he was of little help to me, so I have sent him home. His return should serve as fair warning to those who are faint of heart. I just made all of that up. I hope you all know that. Baka mabanggit nyo lang kung kanino, I don't really need any more enemies, okay? But seriously, I did all of that, I wrote all of that, so that we could see the pattern that is given us here in Philippians, and that it is very, very different from all of that. So different, it's like day from night. You see, Paul does all of that. He clearly identifies Epaphroditus' work and ministry with his own, very deliberately and with much thought, as evidenced by his choice of words. He does that in addition to placing Timothy and Epaphroditus side by side on pedestals, knowing fully well how different their work and ministries were. But remarkably, the Holy Spirit gets Paul to do that gently, carefully measuring words. And he does it as though he's unaware of how people, church people then, and church people today behave. That there are church people today who abuse those like Epaphroditus. That there are church people today who believe and more importantly behave without giving it any second thought that there are such things as first class work and ministry, and that there are those that are merely second class or even lower. Think about it. These distinctions continue to be made today, and they are expressed distinctions that are done again and again between the clergy and the laity, those who are in vocational Christian ministry and those who are merely laymen, or those who have significant ministry versus those who are merely housewives. Need I say more? What do we know so far about Epaphroditus? That the man was genuinely treasured by Paul, that deliberately and with much thought, Paul considered him a brother, a fellow worker, a fellow soldier, and on top of all of that, an apostolos, a messenger, and like his protege, Timothy, no less a laetorgos, a minister. Let's get back to our text. We've got a lot more ground to cover. And to think at one point, I thought this was just a trivial passage. Philippians chapter 2, verse 30 says, he came close to death for the work of Christ, risking his life to complete what was deficient in your service to me. Now there's a serious and vital principle there. Most important that we understand it. That principle is carved in stone in the Gospel of Matthew. Matthew chapter 10, verses 40 to 42. Let me read it for you. He who receives you, receives me. And he who receives me, receives him who sent me. He who receives a prophet in the name of a prophet, shall receive a prophet's reward. And he who receives a righteous man in the name of a righteous man, shall receive a righteous man's reward. And whoever in the name of a disciple gives to one of these little ones even a cup of cold water to drink, truly I say to you, he shall not lose his reward. What is all of that saying? Very simply, that anyone who is serving in the ministry, doing whatever he has been called to do, is going about doing the work of Christ. Here's how the logic simply flows. To facilitate the proclamation of the gospel by assisting anyone proclaiming it is to enter into their work and to enter into their reward. To show hospitality to a prophet like the Shunammite woman did to the prophet Elijah is to participate in the prophet's ministry, 2 Kings chapter 4. To minister to the Apostle Paul, as Epaphroditus did, was to participate in Paul's apostolic ministry. And here's the mind-blowing thing. Having done that, Epaphroditus entered into Paul's reward. Very clearly, Epaphroditus' work and ministry had become a real and integral part of the work of Christ. That is why Paul speaks of Epaphroditus, his work, and his ministry the way he does, in the highest possible terms. It's also why Paul never differentiated his work and ministry from the work and ministries of Timothy and Epaphroditus. That's why Paul never compares ministers and ministries, and doesn't do that even of spiritual gifting. Look at Paul's harsh words directed to those who do that. 2 Corinthians chapter 10, in verse 12, "For we are not bold to class or compare ourselves with some of those who commend themselves. But when they measure themselves by themselves and compare themselves with themselves, they are without any understanding." That's really harsh words. Evidently, the Corinthians were making inappropriate, even malicious comparisons of Paul's teaching and preaching with the more sophisticated techniques of others. We find that in 1 Corinthians chapter 1, verse 10. So, 2 Corinthians. They were also comparing spiritual gifts. They did that in 1 Corinthians chapter 12 through 14. They preferred superior and spectacular gifts. And those like Paul, who in their minds did not have that superior gift, well, he was looked down upon. We see Paul's kind and yet to the point and complete answer to all of that in 1 Corinthians chapter 12, verse 12 and following. That the church is like a human body, that the contribution of every member is essential to the health of the whole body. That is precisely how and why Paul interacts and relates the way he does to Timothy and to Epaphroditus. They are very different men with very different ministries, but they are both of them a vital and valuable part of the body of Christ. They were both actively in the work of Christ. And because they were, Paul adamantly refuses to elevate one above the other. Paul actually goes beyond that. He just as adamantly refuses to elevate himself above the ministry of Epaphroditus. Is there any doubt that Paul would have strongly condemned the distinctions and the comparisons the church people today make? No doubt he would soundly rebuke those who continue to make clergy versus laity distinctions today, and continue to do that despite being reminded that it is grossly wrong to take that position again and again. And no doubt he would do the same for full-time versus part-time classifications made today again and again. The Apostle Paul wouldn't have looked kindly at any of those then, and he most certainly wouldn't look kindly at any of that in our time. So, thus far, on Epaphroditus, we know this, we know quite a bit now, don't we? That the man was genuinely treasured by Paul, and that secondly, he was actively engaged in the work of Christ. That no less than Timothy, or even the Apostle Paul, Epaphroditus was a vital and valuable part of the body of Christ, just as engaged in the work of Christ. Now, here's another important thing we shouldn't miss. Did you notice what Paul was saying in verses 28 to 29? Paul is calling the Philippians to give Epaphroditus a hero's welcome when he gets back to Philippi. He was longing for you all, distressed because you had heard that he was sick. Then verse 28 says, "I've sent him all the more eagerly so that you all, when you see him again, may rejoice." And verse 29, "Receive him then in the Lord with all joy and hold men like him in high regard." Do you see the picture that Paul is painting here? It's very clearly of Epaphroditus' return to Philippi. And notice that he's vividly and clearly painting that event as one of a hero coming back. He's calling for what amounts to a parade down Wall Street, a parade down Manhattan, with Epaphroditus riding the back of an open convertible through showers of confetti and ticker tape. That's what he's calling for. And as you catch the full impact of that picture that he's painting, remember again who he's calling them to do that for. This is not a superstar like the apostles Peter or Paul, not a major celebrity like the apostle John, or one, who was one of the favored ones who was up at the Mount of Transfiguration. It's not even one of the minor ones like Apollos, who comes out of a reputation as a great preacher, or a celebrity or because of blood affinity like James, the Lord's brother. No. Remember, this is Epaphroditus. Remember that if you had somehow missed this obscure verses in Philippians, you would never would have even heard of this guy. Who's that? You would have asked, and somebody scratching his head might have said, "Don't know. I think he's Paul's chuchumeco," or something like that. See, we can readily visualize the work that Epaphroditus did by looking at Paul's needs at the time. Paul had basic food and clothing needs. We're told of that in 2 Timothy chapter 4. But more importantly, he needed help to keep up with his writing to the various churches while he was in prison. Paul, he needed a trusty courier to hand deliver his letters to the churches and to bring back a response from them to him. Epaphroditus ministered to Paul in these very simple and very practical ways so that Paul could carry on with his apostolic ministry while he was in prison. Now there are some, like Calvin, who hold that Epaphroditus was a minister, much like that as he was of Paul and Timothy. I strongly disagree. I do that because there is absolutely no support for that from the text. I'm convinced Chuchumeco wasn't very far off the mark. I'm convinced Epaphroditus was simply Paul's trusty and totally reliable alalay. That's what he was. And so, continuing our portrait of Epaphroditus, he was a man genuinely treasured by Paul. He was a man actively engaged in the work of Christ. He was unsung and an improbable hero of the faith. But he was a trusty courier who hand-delivered Paul's letters to his churches and waited on those responses for Paul. He labored behind the scenes, away from the limelight. He was undeterred in doing that even when he was overtaken by a threatening serious illness. He was very clearly an unsung, improbable hero of the faith. And Paul called the Philippians, to honor and to recognize that he was such a one. And then too, maybe you didn't notice this, that in verse 29, Paul says, we are to use Epaphroditus as a sterling example of a kind of man that we should esteem and hold up. That's in, again, in verses 29 to 30, hold men like him, it says, in high regard. Did you hear what he just said? He says that we ought to esteem and hold him up and those like him, not necessarily those who are most charismatic, the most gifted, the most successful, which is what we typically do. He says, hold men like Epaphroditus in high regard. He says, look for those who are humble servants, faithfully carrying out their service. Even the stout-hearted men who would not abandon their posts, even in the face of illness, and those who are willing to lay down their lives if necessary. Look for men, he says, like Epaphroditus, who probably serve backstage, behind the scenes, who serve under the radar, away from the public attention and admiration. Wow! What are we going to do with that? Is that for real? Seriously, men like Epaphroditus? Maybe it's a kind of hyperbole for maximum effect. But I don't think so. Consider how Paul closes his commendation of Epaphroditus in verse 30. He closes by drawing our attention to his faithful work and service for Christ. He points out, number one, Epaphroditus almost died in the service. Number two, Paul and ultimately Christ was doing his work through Epaphroditus. And three, that when the work of a servant is seen as the work of Christ, that work takes on a new dimension of both meaning and value. By saying Epaphroditus came close to death, Paul, I want you to hear, is very deliberately drawing a clear verbal parallel to Philippians chapter 2, verses 7 and 8. Epaphroditus came near to death as Christ was obedient unto death. Definitely not hyperbole. Paul was obviously dead serious. He was simply closing the loop. He was coming around back to that unforgettable Christological passage in Philippians chapter 2, verses 7 and 8 on humility and servanthood. Remember that? Philippians 2, 7 and 8. Christ emptied himself, taking the form of a bond servant, and being made in the likeness of men, being found in the appearance as a man, he humbled himself by being obedient to the point of death, even death on the cross. Do you see how Paul uses Epaphroditus' homecoming to model how we should honor men like him? Paul deliberately uses this close parallel between Epaphroditus and Christ to say honor given to people like Epaphroditus is really honor given to Christ. And oh, just one more thing. Understand that this is not just a one-off thing Paul is calling for. The verb echo, translated hold men like him in high regard, carries the idea of continuously honoring. And because those who serve backstage under the radar are so very often badly taken for granted across the board, it really isn't very difficult to tap into our guilt that we're doing that. It's actually easy to get people enthusiastic and really into doing a one-off event to honor and to feed men like Epaphroditus. It's not very difficult. Easier even if we can gather them all together, do a grand event for all of them together. That's why a volunteer's night during the holiday season is really a no-brainer. It's a breeze to put together. We did something like that, by the way. We put a cantata and a Christmas barrio fiesta together 3 years ago. Some of you might remember that. It was a big hit, standing room only. Everyone thoroughly enjoyed the thing and were talking about it for weeks. It was a great feel-good thing for everyone. Leaders, for volunteers, everyone who came. Clearly a great and fine thing to do. And we should keep doing it. But understand that as good as that was, Paul is asking us to do far more. He's asking for determined effort, mindset and action to hold men like Epaphroditus in continuing high regard. And that is going to take far more deliberate thinking, planning, and action to pull off. By the way, we began to take that idea up at the GFC elders meeting a few weeks ago, and we'll pick that thing up again when we meet next, I'm sure. Pray that we take it all the way through. It's a great and good thing to do that. Let's complete our portrait of Epaphroditus. He was a man genuinely treasured by Paul. He's a man engaged in the work of Christ. He was an unsung and improbable hero of the faith. And lastly, Paul says, Epaphroditus is a prototype of a kind of man we all ought to always honor and to esteem. Paul's solemn instruction to the Philippians and to us, hold men like Epaphroditus in continuing high regard. God knows we won't do that naturally. that we naturally do that to those who are gifted, to those who have an imposing stage presence, and that we do that instinctively for those who are obviously successful. That's why James chapter 2, verse 2 reminds us, cautions us that our natural tendency is to hold up those who are wearing fine clothes and wear gold rings. It's an awful thing. But this is probably why doing grand events to honor and to esteem men like Epaphroditus doesn't come naturally to us. Let's make sure GFC always honors and esteems men like Epaphroditus. That's one of the pluses of a smallish, dedicated, and determined church. That we can always be a church that really believes and holds that people are more important. People are more important than contracts, more important than rule books, more important than policy manuals, and especially so, people like Epaphroditus. Those who labor behind the scenes, those out of the limelight, those who work under the radar. Hold us accountable, brothers and sisters. Make sure this never become just words to us. Help us make sure that as we grow in reach, grow in responsibility, maybe even grow in numbers, that this shall never, ever become just words to us. People are more important. How do we do that? Well, how about we start by doing what Paul solemnly calls the Philippians to do? Even now, we have many who are like Epaphroditus. We have many who are not too far behind, those who serve out of the limelight, those whose work isn't that evident, not really that appreciated. They serve with all of their hearts because they do the work of Christ. Even now, we have many like those, some who would probably do that work despite being seriously ill, perhaps being sick even to the point of death, like Epaphroditus. Let's start by honoring and recognizing them. Let's treasure those who serve us as IT and equipment techs. Those who serve unnoticed, mostly in the worship teams. They are unnoticed because you hardly ever see their faces. They serve with their backs behind you. In front of you, rather, I should say that. Let's treasure those who serve us as admin staff. And let's not forget those who are grunts, those who lug this heavy audiovisual equipment every Sunday and every Thursday when we do PDF 242. Let's not forget any of those people. And as we come away from here, my friends, may I ask you, let's not just make these words. May I ask you to go out of your way to go and recognize, say a nice thing or two to one of these people, or hopefully to all that you can see today. Do know, tignan nyo, behind the lights that I cannot see from, there are people there that you should recognize. They serve away from the limelight. You don't even know their names, I suppose. But you can know that name this morning. Okay, and that's exactly what Paul in Philippians is calling us to do. We will get to know them, many of these volunteers, when we feed them formally during the holidays, but now you can start and do that, can't you? You can. Let's pray. Lord, I pray that you would allow us to step out of our comfort zones this morning and just prod us, maybe stick us on the side somewhere, sometime, so that we will go to one of these people that hardly ever gets noticed, people that we don't possibly even know the names of, and help us to go and recognize him, if only just this morning, and then to follow through, because that's what we're called to do. To do this always, to hold him in high esteem in a continuing way. Help us to do that, Lord, because this is exactly what you call us to do. Thank you. In Christ's name we pray. Amen.